Hey, welcome. Good morning.
Good morning.
Hi, Bruce Melnick.
What do you have for us
today? Oh, this is going to be awesome. There's so much to see here. Let's go.
We're at the Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex. This place is awesome. I mean, you can only see a very small percentage of what this place has to offer, but I tell people when they come here that you need to take at least 2 days here. You can't see everything that's here in just one day. This is where the Space Shuttle Atlantis is, which is kind of like our marquee exhibit here. It actually houses the Space Shuttle Atlantis that flew in space 33 times. And out here in front of it, that's a full-scale external tank with solid rocket boosters. And of course, that's what gives you all the propulsion and all the fuel for the Space Shuttle to go fly, in addition to the three engines on the Space Shuttle. But that exhibit right there, when you go inside and take a look at Atlantis, it'll put a tear in your eye. When you walk up the ramp, Kevin, you're gonna go through a show that's gonna talk about the development of the Space Shuttle and how it all came to fruition. And then you're going to go into another room and go through it's almost like a three-dimensional shuttle launch experience inside. And then you're going to see the shuttle behind a curtain. And then when the curtain raises, you're actually going to be right in front of Atlantis. And when you walk in, there's just not just the Space Shuttle, which is what you're going to focus on, but there's the Hubble Space Telescope in there. There's a lot of exhibits where you can see inside the cockpit of the Space Shuttle. There's simulators downstairs where you can actually dock the Space Shuttle to space station. There's a lot in there. I did not fly in Atlantis. I flew on the 11th Flight of Discovery back in 1990. Very short mission, just a 4-day mission. We deployed a satellite called Ulysses that went into a polar orbit around the sun. Had to go to Jupiter first, but there's smart people that figure that stuff out. And then in 1992, I flew on the very first flight of Endeavour, which was really cool I was a helicopter test pilot, and to be on a test flight of a space shuttle, that's a whole different critter. And we were on what was scheduled to be a 7-day mission, but we had some trouble in capturing this satellite and attaching a new rocket motor to it, so we ended up extending the flight for 9 days. Two great flights. This has been the workhorse. There's never been a spaceship like it. And when you think about something that takes off and then can land like an airplane, you know, I don't know that we'll ever get there again, because the most efficient way to get to space is a capsule. But when you need to carry huge payloads up and back to space, the Space Shuttle was the machine to do it. And to have one here, one of only three ever, is really special. And the way it's displayed here, there's another one, you know, up in Washington, D.C., there's another one out in California, but this is the best. We have Planet Play here, which is an exhibit that was built especially for the kids. Kids love this place. They love to see, you know, the astronaut here, which we'll have an astronaut here every day that goes ahead and does what we call the astronaut encounter. And you'll get to ask an astronaut questions. We have a facility where you can have lunch with an astronaut. But Planet Play is just for the kids, where they can climb on these nets and cargo nets, and there's things in there for them to do to keep them entertained throughout the day and give the parents a break, matter of fact. There's a place in there for the parents to relax while the kids are just off and playing. And one of the neat things about Planet Play is when the kids get in there, you know, they're into video games and a lot of things like that these days, but there they can get into some hands-on things and get inspired about flying into space. You know, when I was a kid, we didn't have things like that. You know, we didn't have video games. And if you wanted to see what it was like in space, you had to go fly. So that inspired me, but now we've got something like Planet Play that can inspire this next generation. What's there is the history of human spaceflight. You start with a Mercury Redstone, which is the first rocket that Alan Shepard flew on, which was the one that I first heard about when I was in the sixth grade, which inspired me, and I said, man, I'd really like to do that. But then you've got the Gemini Titan. You've got a Mercury Atlas there. You've got one of the experimental early stages of the Saturn 1B there. So pretty much all of the rockets that led up to human space flight in the space shuttle are all there. There's even some earlier flights that were just unmanned rockets, that Mercury Vanguard or Atlas Vanguard. There's other rockets there that led up to us feeling like we were safe enough to fly humans in space. The VAB is legendary. Matter of fact, it is so big. It used to be the largest by volume building on the planet, but then Boeing, I think, pass them up when building 747. But it is so large and so much volume that it actually creates its own weather in there. You can go inside the VAB, which is where we stacked the Saturn V rockets, and then we converted it to stack the space shuttles in there. And now we're stacking the NASA's new space launch system in there. So it's been a very versatile building, but it's huge. I've actually seen fog form in there. I've seen rain form in there. It's just a really neat building. One of the things you need to hop on the bus here and take the tour out to Saturn V. And one of the amazing things when you get to the exhibit is you go through a show that talks about, you know, the space race and finally getting to the moon. And then you can sit in the actual launch console, the launch complex, the firing room with the consoles that actually launched man to the moon, and go through the launch sequence. And then when you walk out through the doors, you walk out right behind the bottom first stage of the Saturn V. And it's got its engines right there, and you look up and it's like huge. We think the space shuttle external tank and solid rocket boosters is huge. You look at that Saturn V, and then you walk along the first stage, and then you walk the second stage, and then you walk you walk forever till you get to the final tip top, and you get to this little bitty capsule, which is the only part that took three men to the moon and back, and that was the only part that came back and to land in the ocean. You know, I stop whatever I'm doing whenever I know a launch is going up. It's just such a dynamic experience. And of course, you can't get real close to them. And what to me, Kevin, is amazing is how you'll sit there and you'll see the candlelight and you'll see the rocket go up and you don't hear anything. And then all of a sudden you start feeling this ground rumble and you feel it and you hear it and you just experience the whole launch and just watch it through staging. It's exciting. Especially the human spaceflight launches, you know, I still get a tear in my eye whenever I see one of those. And I think I was talking to Patrice earlier about how, you know, I've had a tear in my eye for every launch that I've witnessed, except for two, and that was the two I was sitting inside of. But what blows my mind is that people don't even realize that we've had human beings permanently living in space for 21 years now. I mean, the space station has been permanently inhabited since, you know, the year 2000. And the work that they're doing up there and accomplishing up there and the way they're getting up there and the way we're sending cargo up there, and people don't even know that's going on. And to me, it's just amazing. Ed talked about the International Space Station. When I was selected as an astronaut in 1987, I thought that I was going to be in the first group of space station commanders. Well, as we know, there was a lot of delays in the program, but I was excited about getting to space station. The bad news is I was there from 90 to 92, and we hadn't even flown to the space station Mir yet. So the short answer is yes, I'd love to go up and do a stint on space station. I think I could easily spend a year up there. It's, you know, not having been there, that's easy to say. But yeah, I'd like to be doing that. Again, that blows my mind that we can send something to Mars, have it land, and now not only have it land, but explore the surface of Mars, but now we're flying drones on Mars. Come on. I mean, that's something that to me is still science fiction, but it's amazing the brilliant people we have in this country that can pull programs together like that and just be successful all the time. Well, this whole area has got plenty for RVers. Like you said, you know, if you're going to watch a launch, there's no place better than Jetty Park to sit on top of your RV and look there. Here at the Kennedy Space Center, we've got RV parking, so you can just drive your RV right here to the visitor complex and park your RV and enjoy everything we have to offer here. We've got the whole space coast here where there's plenty of fine dining. You've got surfing down in Cocoa Beach. There's a lot to do here when you bring your RV and stay for a while.
That was a blast.
Absolutely.
A literal blast. Oh my goodness. Thank you.
All right.
We need to spend 2 days here next time.
Absolutely.